So even the messages will also be recorded, right? So I'm hoping some more students will join the session. In meantime, there is one announcement on the course page. I think most of you are logged into your course pages. So kindly go through this course page, the front page of your course, Internet Technologies. So there is something, an announcement, practical task requirements. You can open this document and you can just see some of the requirements that are needed for you to execute some programs which are related to our course, Internet Technologies. So anyway, this will be available on the practical course page too, as well as here. So you can go through it once the session is over. You can check your laptops and other things, but I will give you some information related to the practicals. Kindly hold on. Some more people will be joining our session so that they can also get that information. One more announcement. So you can see that there is a link here, virtual class, interactive session link on every Monday, 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. So this timings is based on the timetable which has already been circulated to you, and this is available on the announcement sections too. Maybe in case the next week, if the timings get changed, obviously the timings on this link also gets updated. So always we will not pass on the links every time we are going to have some meetings, but so please keep regularly see these particular announcements, so that you'll get the updated information when we are having the virtual classes and some other information which is passed on to you. So at least once in a day, you need to keep checking this particular information which has been posted onto the course pages. So as of now, we have 31 students. Okay, let us start our discussion. Anyway, in continuation to the last session, I was asking you to inform us whether you are having your laptops and internet connections are available with you. In other terms, you can have access to the internet. So far, I have received only 4 responses. So I am not sure how many of you are having laptops and the access to the internet is there for you. I request, because unless until the confirmation does not come from each of you, then we cannot assume it and we cannot go forward. We need to take some procedure to be incorporated for conducting our lab practicals properly. So I kindly request you once again, and we also urge you, please try to respond to the queries that we are posting either orally or onto our websites. So if you are just silent and you are not responding, then it will be very difficult for us to take appropriate decision. So I request you, once this session is over, we can also conduct a poll session here, but this polling is not an appropriate thing. So I request you to respond to the emails. So you can give your responses through the emails so that those emails are getting recorded for us. It will be acting like a proof for us that the resources are available to you. So that's why I request you to send your responses regarding your availability of the laptop and the internet access your laptop. So that is one important announcement. Please kindly respond to that. And I think by this time, almost half of the class is now in the live session too. So you might have observed that there is some materials available on the course pages. So week one, scheduled from 31st August to 5th September, the following topics have been given here. So you have video lessons are there. You have a PDF documents are available to you, except the quizzes. I'll get back to you this quiz in the later part of our discussions. So week one, you can see there are three topics, three different topics, but all are under the heading of week one. So we have just divided the week one topics into different parts. So these are all again in relation to the prescribed syllabus. So you can see the syllabus copy. The syllabus copy is also available here. Since this is a virtual classroom session, what we are trying to do here is a flipped classroom. The meaning of flipped classroom is that the material is already made available to you. So you can go through this material before an interactive session like this happens. And these some activities have been given here. You need to complete those activities before the interactive session. Of course, since this is a beginning, that is a starting day of this week, you may not be able to complete all the activities. So do not worry about this at this point of time. You can as well complete during the week. And the doubts related to this particular week session can even be asked on the coming Monday. So every week you'll have certain topics. So we have planned like this. For this week, we are discussing the basic information related to the internet technologies, that we start with something called as the protocols, which have been used on the application layer of the OSI reference model. So we start with the basic introduction to application layer protocol. So if you see this material, we have prepared some slides along with some material. So in this session, we are discussing something around the components of a data communication system. So what we need to understand here is this internet technologies course requires some basic information about the data communication and the computer networks. So that is a requirement basically. Of course, it's not a complete prerequisite as such, but some knowledge on data communication systems and the computer networks is very much required. That's why we started. Of course, these terms, these names are not there in your syllabus, but we like to give you some preliminary information related to this data communication system and the computer networks. That's why we started with this topic. So this topic, basically, data communication system is very looks like very trivial, but you need to have the internal details very much clearly to be understood by you. So the data communication system contains main components such as the sender, receiver, the message which is being transmitted from one end to the other end, and the message which is being carried forward through the transmission media, which can be either wired or wireless, and the protocols, the rules that governs the information to be transmitted from one end to other end. So that's the point of discussion. You can see that video session over here. You'll get the basic idea. Coming from this data communication system philosophy and the principles of the data communication system, the same philosophy, the principles, the methods are also being followed in the web communication too. In the web communication also, you'll have a similar entities like the sender and the receiver, something like the client and the server. So one of the entity will be asking for some information, the other entity will be trying to process the required information and send back the corresponding data or the information to the requested person. So here, those entities, that information is been given here in this slide. And another important point you need to understand here is something called, what are called services and protocols. So what is called as a service? A service in terms of computer networks. So here, whenever a user is trying to send some data or receive some data from another end, so this is the data transmission is happening through a network. So the network needs to understand what type of service that the users are requesting for, or what type of service the users needs to be provided. So that is called the service. The services are basically, to start understanding, you need to understand a little bit on connectionless and what is called connection oriented, the service components which are existing between the two different entities. And another important point is on the primitives, some set of procedures. So one of them request, the request passed on to the network, and it goes, the request goes to the another user, and that has been indicated to the user and gets the corresponding response based on the request, and that response is being forwarded to the requested user, and the user confirms that whatever he has received here. Something like this, request, confirm, response, indication, they are called primitives, some kind of procedures. Those procedures are getting executed here between the transfer of data from one user to the other user. So similarly, how the data is being transmitted from one end to another end. That's what the next slide is giving to you, which contains several layers or several steps or several stages, which you call it as. So this kind of logical way of, or the conceptualization of transmitting the data from one end to the other end, was initially proposed within open systems interconnection reference model. Logically, it consists of layers. When I say logically, means it really does not exist, but logically the researchers have proposed to prepare some data to be transmitted from one end to the other end. So from the seven layers, here in the diagram you can see only five layers. There are two layers which are missing here. They're basically the session layer and the presentation layer. Of course, we are not very much concerned for this at this moment in this course. That's why I have given just a big picture of what this layer's reference model is. So each layer does some activity, each layer has its own function, and each layer depends on the other layers to do what exactly it has to do. That's what it has been expressed in this particular slide, and it is given in the video. Please go through that video, you'll get some ideas. And followed by that, what is the latest protocol suite that is in practice? That is a TCP/IP, which is again, which is referring to this five layers reference model. Of course, you cannot see the five layers, you will have only four layers. The first two layers, the physical and data link layer, are combined together, which you call it as a network access layer. That's why you can see the four layers, but internally the functions remains the same. So our web communication, the communication which is happening between two entities over the web, is going to follow this particular model. The model is basically your client server model. So this one is given here. Then followed by this slide, we have come across what the client server model is trying to do. The client is a person at one end trying to request some information. The information is present on some other slide, or some other site means to some other location or some other machine. So that information which you are trying to retrieve it over this network, it resembles our TCP/IP model. So that's the point here. And all the slides, the material which have been taken from the textbook, the ebook which is available on our university website. So you can go to our university website. I'll just show you where you can download this entire book. So with respect to the first unit is we are referring to a particular chapter from the book. you can go to our university website, university library website, of course. There is one link here called as Nimbus. You can click that Nimbus link, right? You can sign in to our website. Even students can access this. So once you sign in here, you can go for what are all the available ebooks there. If you know the title of the book, you can just type it at the search bar. So yes, this is the book which we are referring here, Oliver Bonaventure. So this book is as per the license. This was posted on 24 June 2016. So we can use it. These are the license options which are given here so that we can use it and modify according to our requirements. So yes, the book is taken from this one. So this is a book which I'm referring here that is available at this place on this particular university library. So you can download this book. Yes, you can view or download this book. And regarding to our first unit, that is the according to the syllabus, there's application layer protocols. So this is a book. There are two editions of the book. The older edition is 2008 and the second edition is most updated. They are updating in the last year also. The third edition is coming. That's what they say here. This is two. Second edition is there on 2014. So do not worry about that. You can download this particular book. And there are some exercises also in that book. So we are referring to the chapter number 2 of this particular book. So the chapter number 2 is basically our application layer protocols. Almost all the contents are available at this particular chapter number 2. So I request all of you, for the first unit of our Internet Technologies course, please do refer to this particular book. Of course, this is not a compulsory, but we are just giving you some information. You can go through this. You can refer as well to other materials too. So all this, the first topics are available. That is the first topic. They're followed by the transport service on the internet. Even these slides, the information, most of the content is available on that particular book. About that, transmission control protocol and the user data protocol. This is what the reference sir has given to you. And as well, you can refer to the request for comments with this is a basic information. You can go through it. And if suppose you want to understand the basic operations of TCP and UDP, there are some animation videos available on YouTube as well. You can refer to this. So what we request you is all that material is already given to you with some explanation in the videos form. So whenever you are coming to these interactive sessions, or if you cannot come, you can as well query through our emails and you through messages. So please do get start preparing yourself for this understanding this course. So this is what the week one from 31st August to 5th September. You have topic application layer protocols, names to address resolutions, and what is called email, MIME, and character sets and content encoding. These are the basic information. Of course, as such, all these topics by the name is not seen in your syllabus, but some preliminary knowledge is required for you. That's why the first week is all about some mixture of the syllabus contents with some preliminary knowledge which you require for you to understand the course more clearly in the later part of our study. So this is what I would like to give to you. So now what we are trying to do in this session is basically we open the session for discussion. So here you can ask the queries. You can post your queries on the chat, or you can query through mic. You can use your mic one by one you can try to answer it, so that at least some queries which are burning to you, you can immediately answer it. If you cannot ask for this session, you can also query to us through your emails. So coming to, if you look here, along with the materials of week one, you see there is some quiz one. For each topic, there is a quiz. So what a quiz contains, you might have seen in the sample quizzes. Basically, a quiz contains some questions, and a question can be a multiple choice question, or a question can be a fill in the blank, or a question can be a true or false, or a short answer question with one or two lines. So this quiz is basically will try to assess you how far you have understood this particular topic, or you can call it as a micro topic or a subtopics here. So the quiz one is related to the topics that are being discussed over these video classes or the video lessons and the material which is provided to you here. So similarly, once you complete this quiz, you can go to the next topic. So if you follow the same sequence in the order in which the topics are being presented here, then the logical flow, that is the understanding of the subject, is what you can easily get on with that subject. Of course, we can say that fairly you can understand the course in the beginning stage, and we can assure you that the knowledge that you are going to gain and build up your knowledge base with proper steps, that will be mostly useful for your career in the later part of your other courses too. So please do not jump from a particular topic to another topic. What I mean to say is, please go in the same sequence what we give it here. So this week one, follow in the same sequence. After the topic of application layer protocols, you try to understand what is called a host name, what is called a domain name, how a domain name is being translated to an IP address of a machine. So if you go into the same sequence, then you will try to understand the logical flow contents very easily, and it will be remembered for a longer period of time. So for each topics, there is a corresponding quiz. That quiz contains questions, around 10 questions, and you need to answer those quizzes. Similarly, at the end of the week, there will be an assignment. So this assignment will be again related to the topics which have been presented and covered during that particular week. And you'll be given time limit to submit this assignment, not immediately in one day or 2 days. We'll give you sufficient time. It can be 1 week to 10 days. So logically speaking, the same topics, whatever you are seeing in this one, week one, you can refer to another 2 weeks. So if you are in regular, you should be able to complete within the second week of all these activities and these assignments. If you are not regular, in the sense that if you are not looking very serious, then these things will be delayed further. So don't think that you have given time and you can do it all it in the last minute. What I observed in the sample tests, that sample quizzes you have given yesterday evening, around 40 to 50 students have submitted their assignments. That the Sunday is the last day. So initially there are only 14 to 20 people, and in the last minute people are rushing towards submitting their assignments. Assignments, again, multiple times the assignments were submitted. So this type of activity is not a good activity for you to, means during the learning stage, you should not do this kind of activities. That means you need should not wait till the last minute. So we urge you, please try to avoid these last minute submissions. Why? Because these last minute submissions always will make you have some problems. So when I'm started seeing those assignments, there are a lot of errors, corrections are there. I'll get back to that in the latest, the next part of our video session. But let me tell you, please do not rashly or just in a quick submission you try to do all this, because these assignments, what you're going to submit from today onwards, remember they are going to be evaluated and they're going to be assessed, and their marks are going to be counted for your semester evaluation. When I say for semester admission, how many marks are going to be allotted and all, I cannot say at this moment. But most likely, if you see this particular tendency here, so every topic, one quiz will be there. So there are three different topics in week one. So like this, three quizzes will be there. And every week, there will be one assignment. So I like to just make you to understand here is that all these quizzes and assignments that you are going to submit this entire semester, their average will be taken for your evaluation. So roughly around, you will have 12 into 3, 36 quizzes and 12 assignments. So we will see where you have to take a best of some assignments or best of some quizzes. That I'll get back to you later. But please do remember, all quizzes and all assignments, please do submit on time. And don't rush. And don't just simply submit some things which you just simply copy paste. Please avoid it. One more important point I'm telling, I have seen that we are putting some plagiarism software checking tool on this Moodle website. So some of the students are copying and pasting from the websites, and the plagiarism is going to be known. So we please do not go into that particular extent of getting the things in a wrong direction. So please try to avoid copy paste. So when we ask you to submit the assignments, please submit it on to the point. Simply don't copy and paste it for either from the internet source or from your friends. So once we identify something has been plagiarized and something has been seen, so there will be a strict action will be taken here. Because see, remember, this is an online platform. Anybody can see your assignments. Anybody can view these things. And when I say anybody, means the not your friends, of course. We, as a teachers, any teacher can see it here, and those things are going to be very much taken into consideration. So you have to be very serious when you are trying to copy and all. If you copy, please provide proper references. There are certain procedures to be followed. So if you need to know what is that procedure and all, we'll try to explain to you. But I hope everybody knows this. So these ethical things you need to follow properly, not overlook them as such. Please try to avoid it. Whatever you do, do it on your own. Your own things will be definitely benefit you a lot in the future. So here, like this every week. So next week contents, please remember, one either on Saturday or Sunday, we'll keep posting the next week course materials and the activities. So why we do not post all the things? Why? Because there are some students who just keep on rushing and just complete the other week activities also. So we'll go not very slowly or not very fastly. We'll go with certain speed. So everybody should be on the track. And during this process, if anybody is facing some problems, you can easily try to answer those things. So week topics will be posted before the week starts. So keep monitoring these particular course pages regularly. That is the one important point you need to be very much aware. So as of now, 45 students are attending this session. So if some of them have missed some of the points, yes, anyway, the recorded portion of this session will be posted onto the course page. You can as well see those things properly. I think Sir Satish Sriram, sir, wants to say something to you. Yes, sir. Please take
over. Yeah, okay. Thank you. One more.
Hello, sir. Hello. Hello, sir. Am I audible to you all, please? Yeah, I'm just posting some hello message. Yeah, am I audible? Okay, I think there is some connection problem from sir. And anyway, okay, so I got some responses. No, Ritesh Kande, you are not able to hear me. Am I audible to all, please? Can you please, at least some of you, please respond? Yeah. Ritesh Kande, yes. Okay, thank you. So when sir comes back, then sir may share some of his views. Okay, thank you. So please do understand that our course is basically a practical course. So when I, let me just give you some information related to the practicals part. So anyway, I've just posted here on the course page the practical task requirements. If you open the practical task requirements, you see software is required for internet technologies practicals. I have given many options to you all, please. See here carefully. Those students who are having laptops, they may have either Windows operating system or an Ubuntu or a Mac. Most likely among these three, or some of you are using a mobile phone also is possible, or a smartphone. When I say a mobile phone, it is a smartphone. So this is an indicative one for you. So what we do here is to start with our practicals from next week onwards. This first two, the editor and the browser. This does not require much installations here. Only thing is, when students who are very much familiar, if already you have done some programming codes using the editors and the IDE environments, then already these things might have installed on your laptops. So students who are not aware of what are all these things. So the except the first two rows, all other things will be started after almost third week. For the next 2 weeks, we will start a simple programming using your HTML. So for this one, what we require is you can have an editor like Notepad++. So editor, what is this editor? I'll just show you how the Notepad++ looks like. This is what your Notepad++ editor is, which is very similar to your Notepad. Every computer, more or less, what we have is the Windows operating system computer will have this Notepad. When you install your operating system itself, you'll have an application called Notepad. So there is a difference between this Notepad and Notepad++. You can see it on the screen. Notepad has got very minimal functionalities. But Notepad++ means many functions are there. So this is basically an editor. You can type your codes. You can type, just this is an editor. Editor is nothing but you can enter your source codes. Your programs can be entered here. So this editor supports different programming languages. So those programming languages, your XMLs, YAMLs, or your C programming, or your PHPs, so on and so forth, your PHP, PostScripts, Perl, Python. You can even write a Python program on this editor. So different types of programming languages these two editors supports. So you can make use of this editor to enter your programs. Those who are having Windows operating system. Similarly, in the Linux operating system too, there are softwares. Even if you don't have any editor, you can use simply the VI editor or Vim editor. Or even Nano, whatever the editors you like to have, you can have that, the Linux operating system. Or you can install other editors too. Like I mentioned here, Notepad++, Sublime editor, or Visual Studio Code. So on my system, even I have the Visual Studio Code editor. Basically, it's going to be an integrated development environment, IDE, which also supports to enter your files. So here you can enter your source files, so on and so forth. So this can also be very much useful for you. You can enter your source codes in this Visual Studio Code. This is called as simply Visual Studio Code. So for the first week, you can have these editors. And on your laptops, please make sure if you have any browser, some browser, mostly available browsers are your Chrome or your Mozilla or your Internet Explorer. But make sure that those browsers are supporting JavaScript functionalities. In other terms, JavaScript is enabled on the browser. How do you check whether a JavaScript is enabled on your browser or not? You can, if suppose on my computer now, what you are seeing is a Google Chrome. You can go to the Chrome browser, go to the settings, and you can go to privacy and security, and then the site security is something like this. And you can see at the bottom here in the content settings, you can see I have enabled this on some of your computers or on some of your browsers. This may be in off state. So just you need to enable that. Then if it is enabled, then this is JavaScript is allowed. So this is on your Chrome browser. Similarly, when you go to Internet Explorer, you can go to the options and the settings and make sure you are enabling this functionality to run on your browsers. So that's it for this coming 2 weeks, 2 to 3 weeks labs. We will be concentrating on this first two rows. So those who are having Internet Explorer, you can do even in Mozilla. So anything is whichever browser is available to you, even your Netscape, those who are having, even if you have other browsers also, no problem, no need to install any other new browsers. And similarly, but for an editor, you can have Sublime software as an editor, which is very much friendly, or you can use it Visual Studio Code, whichever is going to be easy for you. But please remember, start practicing in using these editors from now onwards, and this will be continued for your life. As long as you are in the IT field and writing programs in your industry also, it will be useful for you. So there are certain advantages of Visual Studio Code and the Sublime editors. So you can include some servers to be running in the background of these editors. Of course, Notepad is just an editor. You cannot run your Node.js server on this Notepad. Means some servers, means some additional programs cannot be run in simple terms. So this Notepad++ is only helpful for you to write some simple HTML, CSS, and JavaScripts, and some other queries to be written easily for handling the DOM objects easily. But other things like Sublime and Visual Studio Code can also have the functionalities to run servers in the background for your applications to run easily. So that's what. Please make sure if those are having laptops, start installing the softwares onto your laptops and make ready. So the make ready means the editor. For the first thing is an editor is required, and another thing to start the practicals, a browser is required. With these two, we will start the practicals, and it will run for another 2 to 3 weeks. Later, I'll tell you how to install your LAMP stack, or your VAMP, or your MAMP, and the databases and other set of softwares, because there are other exercises for these softwares too. So I don't want to confuse you at this moment. Just I've given you a big picture of the softwares that needs to be used by you for this semester. That will give you a big idea. You should be prepared for this one. Yeah. So I could see that still the old tendency of attending the classes lately still is being continued even in the virtual classroom. See, almost now 1 hour is getting over. Of course, maybe some issues will be there at your end, but please try to avoid in attending these things lately, because some of the information you may miss it. Even then, if you don't have time to view the recorded versions, then definitely there will be a missing of your information that is going to be most useful. So please be on time and keep monitoring this particular information. This is posted on our course pages. So this all gets updated every day. Now let us, I will just open the session. If you have any doubts, you please ask me for this, the topic, or any other thoughts. If you have it, please go ahead. As I mentioned to you in the last session, if you are not informing whether you have laptop or internet access is only meant for to install the softwares. So here, for these first two things, once you install your Visual Studio Code or your Sublime or your Notepad++, internet is not required. Yes, for 2-3 weeks, there won't be any internet required once you install the softwares. The installation of software will take only just 2 to 3 minutes. And you should also get yourself acquainted how to install the softwares and all. So if you're having any doubts, please send me the email and I can get back to you, because already the softwares are installed on my laptop. Again, I cannot show you. But during the our programming exercises, definitely I will demonstrate you how the program should be written, how the program should be executed, and how things will go on. That I can directly show you like this in the live sessions. So that will things will happen in the later stage. But for if you are having any installation problems, please keep in touch with me. For this coming weeks, at least by the next week, make sure those are having laptops. Those are not having the laptops, then please let me know. I will make an arrangement of not a laptop, but I will tell you there are other alternate solutions to execute these problems, which are related to this first 2-3 weeks. So how do you go about? Because that needs to be done individually, case by case to the student. That I'll get back to you. Those are having some problems. Those are having the laptops. Even these things, those are having smartphones also. On your smartphone, you have a browser. So the browsers can be Chrome or your Mozilla or Internet Explorer. Even with this also, you can have installation of your editors. A simple editor will be available. And with that, you can write the program and you can run on this browser. So these are all basically related to the syllabus related to the second unit, what I am talking about. Quickly speaking, if you see the syllabus here, in the syllabus, so I will give the demonstration about how do you use the SSH, FTP, and your HTTPs in the next week. But what I am talking about is the browsers and all is for this particular contents, the client-side technologies, HTML, CSS, the JavaScript, DOM, document object modeling, XML, cookies. Except this PHP, all other things, it can be done with that, the editor and the browser. So that's why you can even run on your smartphones too. But still, if you cannot have this laptop, then there are other sources. The source is nothing but, let me just disclose what is it. The source is nothing but your Moodle itself. So in the Moodle, there is a provision to run these things. So we will make arrangement how do you run those things on the Moodle itself. That is another alternate solution we have. So Moodle do provides support for JavaScript, HTML, CSS, and other client-side technologies to be run very easily. Yes. Yes, the session is open. Any doubts? General doubts or some the subject doubts. Basically, this session is meant for to discuss about these topics that are already present. So anyway, today you may have not seen these things, but at least this week, all of you please go through the topics. We can explain to you, because this is not going to be an online session. This is going to be an asynchronous mode of teaching learning process going to be happening here. So please go through this week one topics. Slowly, one by one. Just these are only 15 to 20 minutes video lessons, each topic, 15 to 20 minutes. Similarly, go through the PDF documents, or you can go through your the book contents which I've made available to you here. Sorry, the book is not uploaded here. So you can download the book from where I have mentioned to you, that from our university website. So let me just put the book here itself. Just kindly hold on. I'll just the book so that the book can be made available to you. Sorry, the book, the reference I have given to you here from where I am using this. So you can have it here. If you want the book to be uploaded, and just hold on, where that book is going to be there. I have the book on my computer. So yeah, so this is the entire book, which you can also download from the university website. And the first two chapters is this particular. These are all the basics related to computer networks. So this is what you call it as the services and protocols. So the same diagrams which you see it on my slides too. Please read it. First, you can see the video class. After seeing the video class, see the material which is given in the form of PDF. Then you come to your this textbook. So, and what are the doubts are there? Please raise these doubts in this type of interactive sessions. So this is the same diagrams you can see here. Whatever I kept it on my slides and the video classes, the physical layer transmission of bits. The same diagrams what you see here. So once this is all about the chapter one. Then comes to your chapter two. That's what your application layer protocol. The chapter two, the part two of the application layer protocol is this the same thing. The slides which are available here. So we are in this chapter only now. We have not yet completed this. So entire unit two is all about this. Sorry, unit one. The entire one is all about this. So we'll go through one by one slowly in the topics. Once you read these things, still you have doubts, you can try to get back for interactive sessions. I'm just waiting. Yeah. So I'll just give time for you to have some discussions now. So please look at the contents, then we get back to the doubts. Yeah. I hope everybody is receiving email messages, right? Why? Because according to our system, we can see that their emails have been configured, except one student here, Badal. If Badal is attending sessions, please do confirm your email. And Lal Tulanga, I don't know what is happening to him. Even he has not logged on to the system. Is anybody having any information about Lal Tulanga? Yeah, all except these two students. I think Badal has changed his email ID. I think otherwise okay. But Lal Tulanga is just only one person is missing in this our session. So about the whereabouts of his. So. I just request the class representative, if possible. I think the class representative of MCA Aftab, right? Is it Aftab? Who is the class representative of MCA students, please? You please, either you can say over mic or you can put it on the chat, please. Any MCA student, can you please tell me who is your class representative? Am I audible to you, please?
Yes, you are.
There's very complete silence, sir. I don't know.
Yeah, exactly. Probably they are checking the videos. Let them read through the material. Okay. And then like if they have any doubts, like they can ask us. Yeah. So basically we are around here. Okay. So if you have any doubts, you can ask us. Go through the material, go through the videos, read through the text, read through the book. You can ask us during this session or even during the coming sessions. Okay. Feel free to. But we are around to clarify any doubts if you have. That's the idea of asynchronous learning.
Amandeep saying you have raised one question. What are your views on the .NET framework and should we learn it as well? No, in this course, we are not discussing about the Microsoft's .NET framework. Say basically .NET framework, when you are developing the graphical user interfaces, which those graphical interfaces are going to be run on your systems, the electronic devices. And when you develop an application using .NET, the corresponding compatibility, the required softwares are also to be used on those required devices. So .NET is requires a complex in the sense that those applications are highly depending on that softwares which the platform is used to develop that the necessary product. So that's why .NET, the Microsoft .NET, the C Sharp or your VB or your Visual Java, so those set of softwares, we are not focusing on those set of technologies, the .NET technologies here. Our internet technology subject is basically focusing on this is a web technology. So these .NET basically are towards your system technology, systems oriented, and more towards those applications that are running on the standalone systems. When I say standalone systems, means you develop an application using .NET and that application runs on your computer or on your laptop or on your mobile phone. And of course, web integration is also there in the .NET platform. But our focus is on the technologies which are exclusively meant for the web development. And see, if you see the syllabus here, the syllabus sheet. Right, you see the syllabus. If you see the syllabus, that's what in the last class, the last video meeting say, there are 5 units and all related to your web applications. That web applications, how do you make use of those technologies so that you can transfer the data very easily. So whatever the knowledge that you're going to gain here can be easily deployable, can easily be created, can easily be developed in simple terms, designing and developing the graphical user interfaces, which can run on your browser. Browser, when I say, does what a lightweight system, as well as on a mobile system or an electronic device. So the whatever the knowledge you are going to gain from here can be the product can be easily ported, means that product can easily run on simply as a browser. So once you learn about the JavaScript, we'll see how your artificial intelligence and the machine learning can also be done on your browser. So in the olden days, a lot of infrastructure was required to run your machine learning, deep learning algorithms onto your machines. But nowadays, the technology is much advanced. So you can run your AI and ML algorithms very easily on a browser. When I say browser, is the one which you are seeing here now. So browser things are much advanced. So whatever you can run it on the browser can also be ported onto a small computing devices like onto your mobile phone or onto a smart sensor. So your artificial intelligence algorithms can be easily run on this resource constrained devices. When I say resource constrained, means you have less computational power, that is you are less CPU. CPU is very much in less, in the sense that the CPU computational capacity is very less, and you have less RAM, less storage devices, less IO capabilities. So today's technology is very much advanced, and the miniature electronic devices are coming into picture, where those miniature means small devices where you have only a small processing capability and small storage is there, small set of devices are available to you, but you want some artificial intelligence mechanism to be incorporated onto the devices and make use the devices very smartly. That's why you call it as smart technologies, smart devices. When you say smart, means a device which is having some intelligence. So how do you keep your intelligence onto that devices where the device has got only limited capabilities of processing, storage, that is your memory and IO capabilities. So this, whatever the knowledge you are going to gain from these units will definitely helpful for you to develop those applications which can run on resource constrained devices. When I say resource, resources means CPU is a resource. Memory, the main memory, the RAM is your resource, and other set of IO devices. So whereas your .NET frameworks, yes, .NET frameworks is exclusively meant for to run on a high computational devices. So actually, I meant the ESP, MVC frameworks. Yes, Ruby on Rails is also there as one of the example here. So there is just one example, the model viewing and the controller. So modeling and the viewing and the controller, that is what MVC. We have some example to have on flavor of this, but not completely on the .NET. So the syllabus is basically onto, yes. That will need some understanding of Ruby, right? Yes, of course, the Ruby framework is on the MVC framework itself. So you will get a flavor of what there is another type of framework, which will also help us to develop some applications. But deploying Ruby's programs on different hardware devices is very difficult. But nowadays you can deploy your JavaScript with artificial intelligence algorithms on your low computing devices very easily. That is what the advancements have come into picture. So that's why if you can gain confidence and skills on how to develop web applications which can run on small electronic devices, that is all about the market is, the industry requires. This ASP, Active Server Pages, the Microsoft servers and all, those were in the olden days. That's why now the shift is towards on developing applications to run on low computing devices. I hope I answered your point, Mandeep. Yeah, thank you. Okay, any other questions, please? Yes, this session is meant to clarify your doubts. Please do ask your doubts. Any kind of doubts, don't feel shy. Please come forward. This is one machine learning program with JavaScript. That's what ML5 stands for, your library. So this is the program, how many number of lines, very small number of lines. We can do some classification here. So just to give you some of the program. This is written on your Visual Studio Code. So slowly we'll start using this editors and this. So what I request you is for this coming week, so by the next week, and you should be ready with your editor and your browser. So if you make it ready, that's fine. And if you are unable to do it, please let me know. That's what we are giving time for you. Please do not wait till the last minute. Internet connection is not required all the time. Only thing is you need to either, if you are preferring for Sublime editor, need to download the software, install onto your computer. That's it. Internet is not required. If you are preferring for Visual Studio Code, you need to download the software. You have to install it. Once the installation is completed, internet connection is not required. These are just the settings, the browser. By default, on your laptop, definitely 99.9% there will be a browser. You can prefer any of your browsers. So, for as a web programming, Google Chrome is most preferable to run most of your softwares. Similarly, you can use Visual Studio Codes as an editor. Start practicing that. Or your Sublime. Other programming languages also can be supported with this. So either Sublime or Visual Studio Code, either of that is most useful. So the next weekend, please be ready with your laptop installing these softwares. This is already, the list is available to you on the post page. We will be developing a full-fledged website by the end of the course. Yes, yes, I guarantee you. That is in not at by the end of the course, but by at least by assignment 3 and assignment 4 will be related to this. So, and that will be continued. The assignment 3 and assignment 4 will be related to basically your HTML, CSS, JavaScript. And once we complete the PHP, yes, that's it. Your website is almost ready. And that needs to be updated all the way up to the end of the semester. So we start creating your own websites, and even you can deploy it. I will tell you how, what are the different ways you can even deploy it over the internet freely. You need not have pay any cost for your service providers. So assignment 1 and 2 will be related to unit 1. Assignment 3 and 4 and 5 will be related to unit 2. So this, if you see your seniors, I need to, the assignments will be related to your developing your websites only. It's small, small tasks. Either it can be a website or it can be an email application or other set of small, small tasks, simple applications. So you try to build up a website with small, small tasks, integrate together, and over a period of time, over another 5 to 6 weeks, you will be able to complete your website. You will get the complete idea, of course. There's no doubt in that. Yeah, any other doubts, please, for anyone? I know that some of you might have already done some this JavaScript or HTML or CSS or something like that. So those who already know these things, means web technologies, don't think you already know it, and don't just ignore whatever we are trying to say here. So just you have to be in track so that you can get the sequence, you can get the understanding. Sir, we will learn and implement both PHP and Node, or only a single one of them? See here, basically, if I understand your question properly, both you, as far as the learning is concerned, both PHP as well as Node.js, both are required for you. I will start with, means the second unit, you have PHP. So PHP is basically a parser. When I say parser, is nothing but, you might have understood what is a, you know what a compiler is. What an interpreter is. Similarly, you have something called parser. So what happens is, when you develop a website, something like this, a website requires three important components. Any website what you are seeing here now, please see here carefully, any website, your SCIS, Learn, also website has got three important components. In that, nothing but PHP only, in fact. So any website has got three important things. One is the web server. Second one is your database server, and the third one is the parser. These are the three important things. These are not the only things, but three important things. So when I say a web server, a server, what do you mean by server? A server which tries to serve your request. So whenever you query, so just let me take this example to you, the diagram which we are showing here. With that, I'll try to give you this information here. You can see in this diagram, a simple diagram you see here, client and a server. So in general, a client is a person who requests some information. That's what he's trying to get the information from. Where? From a server. Server is the word which is very generic here. So here you can see there is another small diagram here. This diagram indicates a database. And what is present in this big box? The big box, both this big box and this cylindrical shape small picture, both together here. What, there is a lot of meaning is involved here.
Nagendra, sorry. You have to share the screen.
Oh, sorry. I forgot. One second. So if you see our diagram here, this is what the diagram I'm referring to. So in this diagram, you see a client and there is a server, two different entities, which they are trying to exchange some information. Exchange means both the ways. So a client is a person who is trying to get some information. That's what he is putting some query, he is putting some request, and that request is sent to another machine. That machine is basically called as a server. Server here, please understand that this is a very generic name. When I say generic, means it is a general name. This server word will have different meanings in different contexts. When I say context, means a different instances, at different times, this meaning is going to be slightly changed. So when I say here, a server, this server can be a web server. This server can be a database server. This server can be some web services which trying to give something for us. So here, to start with, this computers has got some softwares. The basic softwares, what here it will be there is, on this computer, one important component is called as web server. When I say web server, means that web is nothing but, what is web? Web is a collection of interconnected documents and resources. So all your documents, all your information is available on this computer. And this computer is present somewhere, not on your building or on your in your room or near to your place. This computer is present somewhere in the world. Somewhere in the world means it is connected through internet. So it is present across the network. This computer is contains some information, like University of Hyderabad. The University of Hyderabad website, when you see this website, www.uohyd.ac.in, what you see, uohyd.ac.in, a lot of information is there. The information about so many departments, so many schools, so many documents are there. All these documents, all this information about this university, about this organization, that information is available on one computer, and that computer has got some IP address. Every computer has got an IP address. So that information is available, all that documents and some resources. The resources, like you keep some softwares here, you keep some information, documents, files and everything. All that information is available on this computer. But where are you? You are far away from this computer, the server. You are sitting somewhere in another country or another location. And along with you, you have some mobile phone, or with you have a laptop. And using a browser on your available system, that electronic device, using that browser, you are requesting for something called uohyd.ac.in. So when you are sitting at this particular side and you are asking for that information, what does uohyd.ac.in contains? That request has been sent to this particular computer. The computer where it is present, in the university or somewhere, some other place. So that request has come. And what this computer is going to do now, there is a program. That program, we call it as a web server program. That web server, that software is trying to process this request and give the response to the requested person. So that's what that is generically called as server. And in this process, when this web server is trying to process this requested information, sometimes it needs to get interaction with the database. Database is a collection of your data where it has been in an organized manner. Some kind of organization is going to be established to keep the data in a proper way. So this web server, along with the database server, they do interact with each other. And whatever the information that this person is requested, that gets processed here. And this web server gives back the result of the processed data to the requested person. So what you see here is there are two servers here. One is a web server and another is a database server. So usually the web servers are something like Apache. Apache is a well-known web server, the open source server. Similarly, you have other web servers too. Then you have another server called database server. A database server, something like your MySQL. You have other database servers too. So Microsoft SQL servers, of course, we'll get back to that in a later stage. So this web server and the database server gets together, interact with each other. They may be those two programs, the database server program and the web server program. Both the softwares, both the programs are residing in the same computer. It is possible. Sometimes they may not be in the same computer. Sometimes this database server is in another machine here. And that another machine becomes a three-tier architecture. This is a client, this is a processor, the server, and there is a database server. It becomes a three-tier. As of now, this is basically a two-tier, two levels. At one end, client level, another end, server level. If you have a database, it can be another server. And if you have like this, you'll have n tier. N tier means n levels. N different levels are going to be there. Of course, each one has its own set of advantages and disadvantages, and the requirements are going to be different. So whenever you develop or whenever you maintain a website, that website contains information about the web pages, the documents related to that particular thing, and some users of that particular website. Those users' data is going to be stored on this database server. So along with the web server and the database server, there is something, another software called a parser. A parser is basically meant for checking the syntactical things, syntactical and semantic things to be monitored here. So that parser is basically, the software is nothing but your PHP. So your hypertext preprocessor, that is basically a parser. It is a software. It is basically an engine. Engine means which tries to process the data that is to be managed between this web server and the database server for the requests that are coming from different clients. So that parser will keep track of all processing the request here. So that parser is going nothing but a software. It is basically, in this case, is PHP. So when you are trying to have some kind of website, so usually you need to have three important things. One is the web server, the other is your database server, and the other one is your parser. So that's why, if you are running all these three on a Windows environment, we call it as a Windows Apache MySQL PHP, WAMP. If you are running this on a Linux operating system, you call it as LAMP, Linux, Apache, MySQL, and PHP. These are all basically servers, at the server side one. If you are going to run on a Mac operating system, you call it as Mac, Apache, MySQL, and PHP. This is a most open source framework or open source tools that are used to build your websites. It is not the only way, it is the best way. It has come, the technology has evolved a lot. And today what you are seeing, our SCIS Learn and SCIS Learn 2 basically is on the LAMP, Linux, Apache, MySQL, and PHP. That is one live example which you are seeing, where on this SCIS Learn, which you are keeping lot of information, lot of users are there, lot of documents are there, lot of activities are going on here. All these are open source again, which is a free of cost, which you are maintaining. So over a period of time, these softwares have evolved a lot. In the olden days, there was a lot of difficulties, a lot of things to be done. But nowadays, it becomes very much flexible and easy to maintain these things. So this PHP is one set of parser which you need to understand. So it has got a scripting language property. When I say scripting language property, means it has its own syntax to write your own set of codes. So that set of logic, the programming logic flow, can be used using those syntax of the PHP. You need to understand the syntax. So any programming language which you are trying to use, it requires certain set of syntaxes, the rules. How do you make use of that programming language? So there are your normal statements, like your conditional statements, your looping statements, your assignment statements, what are the arithmetic, what are all the different set of programming language statements can be easily written using PHP scripting. Using PHP scripts, similar to your C language, only the PHP scripts will be there. Only thing is, little bit of tags will come into picture here. So you will learn this PHP in the second unit, as well as what happens is your Node.js is another server, which is going to run in the background to support some applications data to be processed. When I say application data to be processed, means what happens is something like this. The same diagram again, I'll come back to this. So here, if you see the second diagram, where something like a local host server, the server is not somewhere else. The server is also present in the same computer. The server is not present in a different place. So you can have the server here, you can have the client operations also can be done here. So in order to support the service operations very much easily, you can install the Node.js on this same laptop so that your application can retrieve and process those requests very easily. So both you need to understand here, both has got its own pros and cons, and it will be very much useful and it will be interesting. You see, once you understand these things very slowly, one by one, it is going to be very much interesting. So you will be keeping yourself involved in these things. So both you will be learning. That's what we are doing this. So parsers are, what is the difference between parser and background? The parsers are basically a syntactical checking and a set of rules that are to be governed in processing your instruction. And backend programming languages, basically the backend programming languages are something like your database. Database is what is present in the backend. So the structured query language, SQL language, which will be studying your database course as well as in our course too. So the structured query language has got, it has its own set of syntaxes, it has its own set of commands and instructions. So that parsers is only meant for checking and processing the data, whereas your backend is meant for your, that programming language statements for creating manipulation of data. It has its own set of syntaxes and its own set of commands. So that commands syntaxes are going to be different here for both the things. At present, you can understand in the papers. Okay. We discuss about some queries related to PHP session connectivity in this course. Of course, I told you, yes, see, PHP sessions and cookies. My idea is, that's what I told you, if you see the software requirements I given to you, just hold on. Let me open the software, is what we are sharing to you. If you see the practical task requirements, you see here what I mentioned here, web server plus database server plus parser. If you have Windows operating system, you need to have WAMP. If you're on Linux, you need to have LAMP. If you are on the Mac, you need to have WAMP. These are all, depends on your operating system, on your laptop, you need to have this. And these softwares are open source. You can just simply install. It's just next buttons can be clicked and your software is ready to use. Only thing is, once installed, certain little bit of configuration steps will be there. So these things, and when you come to the second unit, you will understand about, once you install the PHP, you can set the configurations. It means there are some settings up there. Once you go for cookies and sessions, you can just enable those operations on your PHP parser. So you'll see that software, it is not a very big things to be understood, just enabling the settings for the PHP sessions and the cookies to be understood by you. So once you install the PHP, I'll get back to you. How do you set those values for the sessions and the cookies? Yeah. Sir, what happens when a user uploads a file like an image on a website? Is it stored on the server? Yes. So please do remember, what happens when a user uploads a file? Yes, anything that you, if you look to this basic diagram, the diagram is this. When you say upload, the meaning of upload itself is gives you the answer here. So if you see this, our the diagram, again, a lot of meaning is there. It looks like very simple diagram, but a lot of things are happening. So what is this client is doing? The client is trying to upload a file. So here, the meaning of getting information is requesting information. I do understand, but uploading, what you are telling is, I want to upload this. That's what you are telling. It is also a request. Uploading is also one form of request that is going, coming from the client to the server. So what the server will do is upload. When the button, upload button is clicked, the server will know that it needs to be uploaded. Yes, that file can be uploaded onto your database or onto another storage device which is connected to this machine. So usually, there are some mechanisms how do you store your video files, your images, and other multimedia files. So if your, this server doesn't have enough capacity, you cannot store many things. The server has got its own limitations. So it is not unlimited memories, unlimited storage capacity is there. If everybody starts uploading video files and images files, definitely over a shorter period of time, this particular will run short of memory. Shortage of problems will occur here. You cannot upload further. That's why there are certain mechanisms to be followed. How do we upload the video files, images, and all? It all depends on how do we store these images. So once you build up your website, you'll get the ideas by that time. How do you insert your usernames? How do you set? How do you submit certain things to be done on this one? How do you design a website with containing different pages? So I will give you a basic things about designing and developing two to three pages, and I'll tell you how to connect 2 to 3 pages and how the users can log in and do these operations. So once you get that idea, you yourself will know how the things goes on. So that's what you'll learn, all these things. Yes, is it stored on the server? If you want to be uploaded onto your server, you can do it. If you want to only view, you can also provide only view options. That's it. I hope I answered the question related to Amruta. Yeah. Any other questions, please? So here, good general questions you are asking. Yes. By at least the next Monday, I expect many of you to go through this week one topics. So you please refresh yourself in getting those doubts to be clarified very much. Yeah, any other questions, please? I use MongoDB. If you already use MySQL database, Yogesh Gupta, very good. See, what happened? I told you today's technology has much advanced. So, in the olden days, when you are storing this data on your databases, people are using different types of databases. So what is in the olden days, you used to have a type of database management system called as relational database management system. So RDBMS. Oracle, Microsoft SQL, and MySQL, they support a type of database management called as relational database management system, RDBMS. So where your data is stored in the form of tables. A table is nothing but a relation where your attributes are getting related to each other. So that you will study more clearly what is RDBMS in your database course. But in fact, those who know already what is a table, table contains users' information, the user's data, and other entities' data. Table is nothing but an object, an entity's information. So that in the olden days, you used to have only RDBMS. But what happened is, nowadays, if you see the internet technology, means the internet has evolved a lot, where you have billions of users, billions, millions of objects are getting connected with each other, and huge quantity of data is getting from those billions of users and your users and your objects. So like if you see your Facebook or your Google or other social networking websites, you have a lot of data which is coming from those systems. So if you start organizing the data, means if you start storing the data of those Facebook or your other Google's data or some other entities, the huge quantity of IoT devices, data to be stored on the RDBMS, then your data storage is not going to be sufficient. And in order to store and in order to retrieve the data on that tables, it's going to be very difficult. So a lot of time is going to be spent on this to store and retrieve the data on this RDBMS database management systems. So people, instead of going for RDBMS databases, they have come to databases where data need not be stored in the form of relations. So like a simple example, if you have a Facebook account, some users may give pictures in their profiles. Some users may not store their pictures in their profiles. Some users may give some blog items, some users may respond, some users may not respond. So it is not that all users are going to give all the field values. That's why you have most of the field values that are to be stored on the tables will not be containing all the values all the time. So that's the purpose. The MongoDB is another type of database, which is not a relational database management system. So here we store the values in the form of attributes and their corresponding values. So here, whatever the attribute that the user has been using, the corresponding value, if he has used, that only value is going to be stored. So the relational database management systems are different from your MongoDB databases. And these MongoDB databases are very much useful for storing the data related to your huge quantity of data that is getting generated from enormous numbers of peoples, easy to store and easy to retrieve here. So when you study the MongoDB, we'll give the syntax how the data is getting stored. It is not as simple as, means it's not very similar to your MySQL or your SQL statements. Statements can be the same, but the data organization is going to be different. So MongoDB supports a different type of organizing the data, and MySQL supports another way of organizing the data. When it's organizing is the way the data is stored in their databases. So the way the data is stored in the database will help us to retrieve, means get the data very fastly and store the data very efficiently. MongoDBs are very much useful for your today's applications, today's social networking websites and your IoT applications are very much useful to store, means easy way of storing the data and easy way of retrieving the data as compared to MySQL. But there are certain applications which they do require MySQL databases in the backend. So they do prefer for going for those MySQL databases. And those databases which does not require any kind of relational referential integrities and relational attribute values to be maintained, they can go for MongoDB databases. Thus, MongoDB is basically called as key value pairs. Key is basically your attribute, and the value is the corresponding value to your key, that is your attribute. That's why MongoDB supports key value pairs, whereas MySQL supports your table form of storing your data. Well, someone is trying to join in this meeting at this hour. Yeah. Any other doubts, please?
Okay, so this is very good, very interesting questions. Okay, so I also suggest most of you also focus at this week's topics. Okay, so yeah, we will be learning about all these topics in those particular weeks. Okay, please be patient and we'll be discussing all these things in detail. Okay, for the generic audience, like we are also interested in like whether they could understand the week one topics already or not. So please focus at those topics, okay, which are targeted for this week. And the interactive sessions are basically to clarify any doubts if you have, okay, so regarding the topics which were already discussed and already presented. So please focus at them as well. Because in a class like of 80 students, like some of the students are a little bit advanced, some of the students are a little bit lower. So we have to basically go with all the students. So we have to follow the perfect syllabus in the structure. Okay. So I strongly encourage, let's focus at week one topics. Okay. Because like for the people who are a little bit advanced, you are getting a lot more knowledge. But at the same time, like the generic audience will miss the point. Okay, they will not understand like why we are discussing certain topics. Let's go step by step. Okay. So we will learn all the things. Okay. Please be patient. Thank you.
Yeah. I would like to add one more point here. Do we have interactive sessions like this, or will there be a live teaching as well? Sir is going to answer. Yeah.
Let me answer this one. So these interactive sessions, basically, we will try to clarify the doubts regarding the videos and the asynchronous material which we have kept. There will not be any live teaching, okay, as far as at this moment is concerned. But if the COVID situation progresses, okay, probably goes towards better, okay, and eventually if you all will be ending up at the university, then we may have live sessions. Okay, let's hope the best. The live sessions are the best because we can interact directly. But as of now, these interactive sessions are basically to clarify the doubts about the asynchronous material which we have kept. Okay, this is to the point. Okay, hope I'm clear.
Just I would like to add one more point. This course, what I personally feel is does not require a live teaching as well. What I mean to say a live teaching here is, after the first unit is completed, all the remaining four units are basically a practical. So we are going to demonstrate you during our video lessons only. What is that particular statement? How do we try to solve that particular problem? So a small example will be demonstrated live. And we will be giving an activity for you with another problem. So how do we solve the problem? How do you write the program? And how do we execute the program? And how do we give the inputs? And what are the expected outputs? How do you see it? All will be given in the video lesson. So as such, when it is given on the video lesson, you can see clearly how we have done it. And similarly, the steps you need to replicate for other problems to be solved. So these are all practical. When you are doing some practical things, that does not require much emphasis on live classes. Live classes, what I personally feel here, once again I record it. See, live classes are very much required where you have a lot of theory to be discussed. And if you are unable to understand the theory, you need to have a live session there. So for a practical courses, it is very, very much easy because you are recording these things. So when you record what we have done it, similarly, you can replicate the same thing on a different problem. And in that process, you will advance to have your innovative skills in improving that particular problem and how do you solve it problem. It all depends on your practical solvability rather than just simply attending the live session. So live sessions are, for this course, as such, live sessions, if required, we will go it. But it all, because see, now you only 36 students are attending. What happened to the remaining 46 students? So that's why they may miss those live sessions. Of course, it is being recorded and it will be displayed and it will be made available. But so you, Tarun, don't worry about the live sessions. This course does not require much on the live sessions, but this doubts clarification is very much important. So people who are attending this doubts clarification will learn, will gain a lot of knowledge. They will also, they may have some doubts, they may not be able to ask, but if they simply listen to the doubts, their knowledge base also will be improved. And they will definitely sure they will try to have different types of ideas. So that's why I expect all of you to attend this session so that it will be fruitful for you as well as for others also, it will be helpful. So yeah, this is a practical course. We will share our practical things with you. So we will share whatever the practical knowledge we have with us. So that knowledge will definitely be helpful for you to build up your own applications. Ultimately, you have to develop your own applications. You have to be confident on developing on your own. Each individual has to be having its own confidence. It's not a group activity, moreover. So that's why to gain those confidence, you need to attend and you need to do the things on your own. So with the exercises that we give it, from next week onwards, it will be completely practical. Our idea is to give your HTML, CSS, lot of programs to you. Yeah, that's what we don't want to make you to fear at this moment, because some people may be in the beginning stage of this web technologies and they get worried about if we give a lot of programs and all. Only step by step we'll go. So kindly be patient. It's not yet completed. It's just a beginning. So we'll go through definitely. Whatever best we can deliver, whatever best we can share to you, we'll do it. That much assurance we can give it from our side. Do not worry about that. Any other doubts, please? Because we are keeping a video lecture of ours only, we are not keeping any video lectures of somebody else. So our video lectures, if you can listen patiently, and remember, patiently means that a video lecture is only for 10 to 15 minutes or at the maximum 20 minutes. You know that if you put a video lecture for 1 hour, you will not be able to listen properly. May be losing your focus, may be lost for that 1 hour lectures. That's why we have put very, very short videos, very quick videos, but a lot of informative information is there. So you need to be very keen in listening and observing what are the things that we are saying. Every word we utter is going to give you a lot of information over there. So you need to be very much concentratedly listening to that 15 to 20 minutes of videos. Of course, there are a lot of videos on the internet too. YouTube also is available. But remember, we are live in front of you. So we can answer it very easily, whatever the things that you are facing. So that will be definitely helpful for you as a guide. We can make you to understand clearly and very easily, rather than for the videos which are already available on the internet. Yes, please. Any other things, please? Any doubts? It's good that I can see at least 36, 37 students are still listening after 1.5 hour session. Whether they are really listening or just kept their mic and videos mute, I don't know. So at least people are listening to our words. So we will try from next week onwards. Yes, there are three topics, so-called topics, for this to be covered in this week. Yes. Yes, you can see those topics here. Once again, I'm showing to you. So week one, you have something called as application layer protocol, client server model, and the transport and the UDP services. This is topic one. We are not further narrowed. We have divided, if you see the syllabus, based on the syllabus, we are divided into topics. And further, we are not going to sub topics. Host names to address resolutions, the domain names, host names, domain names, DNS resolver is going to be here. And followed by what is, everybody knows email, but have you seen what an email contains? Basically, how many of you seen what original email contains? If you might have seen my video lesson, I have shown you what an original email contains. Have you seen from where that email is getting originated? Or what is the source IP address of that email? Who is sending you that email? And what that email contains? What is that header contains? What is that message body contains? What are the protocols used in that email? So that's technically you need to get an understanding about that email. Week one quiz is graded as marks. Yes. So we would like to just say one thing here. So quizzes, I told you already, every topic will have a quiz, and at every weekend you'll have an assignment. So all these quizzes and assignments will be definitely counted for your final evaluation. And whether to consider the average marks or to consider the best of these marks, that we will tell you in the later stage as the course proceeds. But definitely it will be counted. So all these quizzes you need to attend. And one more important thing, whether you have attended the video session or not, we'll come to know if you are going to answer in this H5P videos. So if you are not attempting the answers in this H5P videos, means you are not listened to those videos, and we'll come to know whether you are listened to that videos properly or not. So your attendance will be monitored when you have observed that video, when you answer that questions or not. Of course, there is no grading on the questions related to H5P. Well, the H5P video sessions are meant to keep track of whether you are attending those video sessions or not, whether you are listening to them and you are following it or not. So the indirect way of attendance is being considered there. So please do answer to the queries that are raised in the H5P video sessions. That is the interactive video session. That's why H5P, that's what the HTML5, H5 means stands for HTML5, the latest technology here. So that processing will enable us to have interaction with you. So we'll keep monitoring those videos. We'll come to know whether you have answered these questions or not. In the log files, we'll have the data. So which student has answered which H5P questions or not. So by that, we'll come to know whether you have viewed that video session or not. You cannot open the videos on the smartphone. On a smartphone, of course, you can. This Moodle website can be used on the, yes, this Moodle website can be used on your mobile app. There is a mobile app available. So you please check it out. There is this video can be easily played on the desktop. You can see on my laptop is getting started over here. So there are questions, not drag also. You have to compulsorily listen to this. So there are some questions at different time intervals. It can be opened on the smartphone. Yes, it can be a mobile app is there. You have to download the Moodle's mobile app. From that mobile app, you can view that particular contents. That requires a browser to be supported, Arun and Amruta. Let me just check over this. Again, I'll get back to you. Even in the Moodle app, mobile app, you cannot play those H5P videos. Let me test it, and again, because already I tested it before and I've seen it. Let me just see it on my mobile phone in front of you. Yes, there is a security measure is there. I will do that enabling of that option. If you are getting that site administration / security / HTTP security, then we will enable that and regular things. So on my mobile phone, just try to resolve it as quickly as possible. Maybe by tomorrow or the after tomorrow, I'll try to resolve it. Not worry about that. Okay, so like this, if there are some notes in the beginning so that we can resolve it, you directly. That's what I am telling, please. There is a security issue is there involved on that mobile phone. I will get back to that in that by the next week for interactive session. This is even, you can see it on my mobile phone. There is a security that has not been enabled. So I will try to resolve that one. I said I will try to resolve it. Most likely it can be done. It is not that it's a difficult task. We will do it in that one. Any other doubts, please? Even if H5P videos are not working, even with the other videos, we have already provided the links to the YouTube, because we are all uploading our videos onto the YouTube server only. So you can as well view our videos on the YouTube too. If you are not getting, sometimes some issues are there. That is an alternative way is there for you.
Actually, it is interesting. I can see the H5P content on the mobile.
It depends on the browser, sir, basically. The browser, what they are using. But anyway, I'll just go through that security feature.
Yeah, okay. I mean, like, we can re-verify it. But at least on my mobile, like, it is working. Okay. So the browser is Android phone, usual. Okay, anyhow, we will check it and get back to you guys. Okay. So on at least some phones, like, it is working. On Android phones, it is working. Just curious, for the people like for whom it is not working, can you please put your phone specifications? Is it iPhone or something else? Say, for example, Arun or Amruta. Just curious.
No, we will try to trace it out, please.
Yeah, Arun is Android. Okay.
Android, which version of operating system you are having, Arun? It is on the Moodle app on iOS. Yes, on iOS, there is a security issue is there. That's what I will try to set it on the Moodle server itself. For iOS, I will try to check it out. But sir, phone is, because even my phone is also on the iOS, so I'll try to do it. I have a phone only, I tried in the mobile. Arun, that is Android 7.1.1. Okay.
Interestingly, he is matching my configuration exactly.
please try to, yeah, we'll try to sort it out, don't worry. One by one, we'll try to sort it out. Any other doubts, please, apart from that? Because that now time is almost getting over. As the course progresses, we will try to get keep updating you about the evaluation procedures and so on and so forth. So do not worry about the evaluations. Please do focus on your programming aspect, because this is a practical course. There are a lot of programming is required. Your programming skills has to be improved. If you are very much confident, then this is what your money is. Your bread and butter will be basically the programming skills for your web development. By the way, I was asking, who is the CR for MCA, please? Please, I forgot, actually. I thought Aftab was there last, not Aftab, I forgot the name. CR for MCA, MCA students. Moni, is having information about your class representative? MCA students, please post it on your chat box. Who is your CR? No, my way of communication is to all of them, but I just am curious to know who is the CR, because at least he'll find out for whereabouts of Lal Tananda. So I stop the recording at this moment.